The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Mullins and Kevin Larame, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night, and welcome to Soccer Today for Tuesday, October 5th, 2021. And as always, Tuesdays are for Europe. And today, Duane, we're going to take a little trip to the Premier League down in England, of course. Well, up in England, depending on where you are in the world. We're going to talk about France a little bit, but more Spain. A couple interesting results. Another defeat for FC Barcelona. Nothing is going well for Barcelona this year. We're going to talk about that. And the Bundesliga, big defeat for Bayern Munich last weekend. But first, controversy in France. Mbappé taking a break from the national team. And a new manager making his comeback in the Premier League after a couple of difficult managerial stint, but a very famous one. In 2016, Claudio Ranieri was hired by Watford to take over for Xisco Muñoz, who was let go last Sunday. But first, Duane, how are you today?
I'm doing well. I've got to stop starting to watch addictive Netflix programming at 10 o'clock at night. Because,
so are you talking about Squid Game again, or did you finish that?
Squid Game's done. I watched Squid Game in one sitting.
Thank you for that, because I was like I was ahead, maybe 3 days ahead of everybody else. So when people are like, what's Squid Game? I'm like, oh, you just watched it? Yeah. Red light, green light. Amazing.
Yeah. It is the cultural phenomenon of the year, really, in a lot of ways. I mean, that and Ted Lasso. But which I haven't watched this week's Ted Lasso either. But what I got stuck in last night is a German show called How to Sell Drugs Online Fast.
That's a show, right? It's not a tutorial, right?
Well, it's a bit of a tutorial, actually. But yeah, you know, the key is to have good coding skills, basically, which I do not. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't be talking to you right now. No, but it's fun, too. All the forum programming on Netflix is pretty good, because basically what they've done is, because nothing was getting made during the pandemic, they had to do something. So they just went and bought all these properties from other countries that were already very successful there.
Yeah.
So
they dubbed it properly. And they dubbed it properly, right? So you're watching that Squid Game, you're like, wait, I don't even realize that it wasn't in English to begin with. It's kind of cool. Well, you're right. All right, let's talk about today's first subject. The first subject today is Claudio Ranieri back in the Premier League, hired by Watford. He takes over for Xisco Muñoz, who was sacked earlier this week. The Spanish former midfielder had a difficult stint at Watford, like the last few managers, but he was hired last December, Xisco Muñoz, and he helped Watford get promoted once again to the Premier League. They've been doing the yo-yo dance over the last 5 to 10 years. Coming up, going down again, coming up, staying. So that's the yo-yo we're talking about. He helped them get back this time to the Premier League, but it's not going well so far. We're going to look at Watford. They're 14th in the table, or they're 15 now with Monday's result. And of course, they had more ambitions this year. And Claudio Ranieri has been hired. Of course, since his famous 2016 Premier League title win with Leicester City, he's had some difficult times, only staying not even two full seasons with Nantes in France. He left Leicester when he was sacked with Leicester in 2017. He went to Nantes. That was his next project. He was supposed to be the one to help them break that glass ceiling of result. Did not work out. Fulham, he was supposed to be the one to bring Fulham back to the Tay Day. He failed the day he was sacked, and the year after they got promoted again. And since then, Fulham has also gone back down and back up. Well, they're down now. And Roma in 2019, he was a caretaker manager there, Duane, before the end of that season in 2019. And then he got hired by Sampdoria, which he was fired from a few months ago. And now in Watford.
Yeah, exactly. A couple angles to talk on this. First, you could talk about the Watford angle. And as I was saying to you off air, Watford's kind of a joke that they're known for just churning through managers. It's just part of their club's DNA. You can have an interesting conversation about whether or not that's a good or a bad thing, because I think our general instinct is it's bad. And I tend to lean that way. But at the same time, you know, as we've talked about a few times on the show, there's that sort of 8 to 10 game window thing that we've, you know, we talked about this in the MLS context this year a lot, particularly with Toronto. It's like they're, you just got to pull the trigger at some point, because the evidence is pretty clear that if it's not going to work out, it's not going to work out, right? He got them back up, as you say, Cisco. Wasn't really flying this year. They're like, it's so hard when you're those clubs, because what is success, right? Like, it's getting to the Premier League. And I think what they want to do is they want to just solidify themselves there.
Yeah, well, getting to the Premier League and staying a year or two just mid-table is actually very good for the financial aspect.
Yeah, but that's Watford's ceiling, right? Like, they're, you know, it's not a club that is probably ever going to attract massive investment, but because it's just not as sexy as other clubs. Now, that said, you never know where people are going to invest. It's another conversation we were having off air as well. Like, sometimes maybe outside the box might be a place that someone could go in with billions. But
we'll talk about this when we talk about FIFA, maybe tomorrow, depending on how much gameplay I can get in today. Because let's just tease it. I've started, because you can build a club, which is new. You create a club. So I created a club, and I'm like, I kind of want to win the Champions League, but I don't want to be bothered with the regular league title. So Switzerland it is. I'm investing $1 billion in Switzerland soccer.
There you go. And maybe someone might do it in Watford, but I think you'd get more bang for your buck in Switzerland, or even just an area. Like, if you don't know where Watford is geographically, it's pretty close to the London area. So it's not the cheapest part of England, right? So anyway, but look, that said, they've moved on. They do this all the time. Ranieri coming in is, you know, look, he's got the name because of his time at Leicester, you know, particularly within English circles. He will always be famous for having done that. But when you look at the rest of his resume, as you mentioned, it's not that it's bad. It's just a certain type of managerial career.
It's the Italian version of Sam Allardyce. Let's be honest.
Pretty much. So, you know, he's going to come in, he's going to do a job for a while, and they have a really tough string right now. If you look at their schedule moving forward, there's a lot of big teams that are coming up. So it's, you know, this is a double whammy that they're pretty low in the table, and they've not had their real tough games yet. So, you know, that's going to be hard. And you watch the quality and display in that Liverpool City game, which I'm sure we'll talk to briefly at some point in this weekend. You know, how can you, if you're looking at Watford and looking at those two teams and going, oh God, we have to play both of them. Anyway, but yeah,
it's true.
You just got to get your 42 points and out. That's what it comes down to. Although lately it's even less than that. It's about 37 points is what the average has been over the last few years. So that's what they got to focus on. Stick there and solidify, and maybe you can get her done from there. And it's, like I said, a few hundred times now, let's not be blinded by this idea that you need to stick with something that's not working. You either have to stick with it or you don't stick with it. And you have to make that don't stick with, you have to pull the trigger quick. And that's what happened.
Watford waited 7 games this season, and they have 2 wins, 1 draw, and 4 losses this year for 7 points. Watford are on a run of a loss and a draw. Before that, a win and then losses too. So you're looking at a record of 1-3-1 over the last 5 games for Watford. They are 15th right now, and they have a difficult few weeks ahead. Who's going to have a difficult few years ahead, maybe, following what was a difficult World Cup final in a penalty shootout for France? Kylian Mbappe. And it's been not only rumored that he wants to leave PSG, he's asked PSG to leave in July. He wanted a good transfer request so that they would get something value from him. Didn't happen. The club is a bit stubborn that way. Who wouldn't be with that type of investment in Kylian Mbappe? But now it's with the French national team, and it's rumored now that he's maybe thinking of taking a break from the French national team. He doesn't appreciate how he was treated or the lack of support after being the victim of racist comments and tons of racial comments after his penalty miss. He was compared to a monkey in different places on social media, and he felt he didn't get the support needed from the French Football Federation. And one of the ways he's thinking that he's a distraction right now, he says, maybe I was told my ego's too big for this team and that's why we lost. Maybe this team will be better served without my ego. And Kylian Mbappe taking a break, maybe, from Libler. Duane, in his career, the next matches he plays for Le Bleu competitively will be his 50th with the national team. He scored 17 goals in 49 games so far. He's a French Player of the Year in 2018 and 2019, and he was awarded the FIFA 2018 World Cup Best Young Player, of course, when they won the World Cup. Interesting to see how this unfolds with the national team, with Didier Deschamps, with everything else that's surrounding France. And of course, I say it in the final, but it's not the final. The France had a very difficult European championship this summer because of that Switzerland-France game in the penalty shootout, right? I think it was the quarterfinals. Was it even a round of 16? It was the quarters, right? So that penalty miss by Kylian Mbappe and the racial comments following that game actually will leave a mark, and we'll see how serious this thing's become.
Yeah, look, I mean, there's a couple things just happening here that we should be careful about first before we get into sort of the personality side of it, and that is the racial stuff that you refer to. And by stuff, I mean abuse. That absolutely is true, and that absolutely would affect anyone, and it absolutely should be taken seriously, and it is not always clear that international footballing bodies, whether they be domestic, like the French Football Association, or whether they be FIFA, take it seriously. And in fact, I think it's pretty clear that they don't do enough to stop it, or they don't know what to do, or they're paralyzed by fear of what to do. And when they do try and do something, they take half measures and then back off from them. Like, look at the Mexican chant, which is a homophobic issue, not a racism issue, but, you know, it's a hate issue is what it comes down to, right? So, yeah. This is all part and parcel of the same kind of idea and package and unfortunate situation that's happening in the world. And you know, so we're not going to dismiss that at all and focus on Mbappe's personality stuff and the conflicts that are happening with the French team entirely. But I do think that, you know, when you're looking at this French team, this used to be Kevin, when I first became a bigger follower of soccer, it was in the 90s. And at that time, the Italian team was known for either use it all the way up, all the way down kind of team.
They win it or they implode. I guess it's the French national team now.
Yeah, exactly. To me, they've kind of flipped spots, Italy and France, because it's the same thing. France, they're passionate cultures. You know, you could speak to that a bit, probably. The French are, you know, passionate culture, and there's a lot of conflict there, and there's a lot of stars there, right? And you have to manage that. They're kind of in a weird situation, too. Where do you go from winning a World Cup? It is hard to sort of focus again, and they didn't have a great Euro for them. You know, they went in as the heavy favorites, and they left, you know, kind of no longer the favorites heading into the World Cup next year. When you're Mbappe, also, you're a young man, you've already won a World Cup. What more is there to accomplish internationally?
Not only have you won a World Cup, you've won a World Cup, you could have done amazingly in the Euro last summer, but it's also club-wise. The only thing you haven't won is basically the Champions League. And it's more when than if he wins it, especially the way it's going to go this year. So you're looking at him, and he wants to eventually join Real Madrid, and that's the dream that hasn't been realized yet. It's that's what's left on his bucket list. We all remember that picture of 11-year-old Kylian Mbappe wearing a Real Madrid tracksuit with Cristiano Ronaldo. Of course, his idol as a player. And like his idol, there's a part of himself that feels he's not being recognized and also treated to the way he wants. And his own team, there's a couple of players that unfortunately will always be attracting the headlines before him. And that's Neymar and that's Messi. And if you are Mbappe, you want to be the man on top of that hill and maybe the one who gives the Galacticos their former glory, which could be needed. That's what's going to happen next summer.
Yeah, and by former, you mean very recent past.
Well, of course, but very recent. For the Galacticos, a couple of years is basically exactly like Dante's journey to hell. It could be just a few seasons, but it feels like 9 stages.
Yeah, I think, you know, with Mbappe, look, I think what he might be doing here is a bit of, don't want to dismiss the racism aspect of this. I want to be clear about that one last time before I say this. You know, he also could be just not particularly motivated to participate in World Cup qualifying, because France will get there, and we can revisit this conversation next fall, right? When the World Cup is upon us, we have a year from now, and it's you know, for countries the size of France, it's fine in this way, and maybe having a little break from each other wouldn't be the worst thing anyway. It's not like they're gonna, you know, suffer for talent. They'll find somebody to go in and replace him. And by the time the World Cup's rolling around, he'll be there. But he could also, like I said, be looking for that break, I guess, to focus on exactly what you just said, to perhaps win a Champions League this year with PSG, and then use that as leverage point to negotiate your way out to find yourself to the club that you want to get to in Real Madrid, which we all think is the case. I don't quite understand why he wants to leave there. Maybe, you know, because it's just, I guess, maybe a childhood fantasy thing.
Yeah,
count that. That's actually kind of adorable in some way, right? That they might maintain some of that. I guess if you can pick any club in the world, you might as well pick that one. But
yeah, well, it's also what you've seen and what you grew up with, and when he was growing up, which is not that long ago, Duane. That's the thing.
When not that long ago, but yeah.
When we started this show, he was not even 14 years old. So that makes sense why he would love Real Madrid. But it's a good thought experiment. And of course, after this short break, we will look at the results in La Liga, because Real Madrid and others are having a difficult season. Nothing is going well in Barcelona. Will he stay? Will he get fired? Ronald Koeman had the kiss of death earlier this year. This week, we'll see if that stays. That and more after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at @SoccerTodaySPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. Kevin Laramie joined by Duane Rollins, as always. And you can follow us on Twitter at 24th Minute for Duane, at Kevin Laramie for myself. And Duane, what you can hear now in the background is the theme music for Kevin Plays. Because later today, I will be playing some FIFA on this Twitter account. And you'll be able to find that video on our YouTube page and everywhere else. Getting ready for our review, hopefully tomorrow, Duane, where we'll review FIFA 22. It's a yearly tradition on this show where I go through some of the new things, some of the interesting aspects, and usually over past it was more geared online, and you know, but we all grew a bit tired of getting our ass kicked online, Duane, and it's now more career based again. It's kind of fun. Looking forward to spending the afternoon getting ready in a couple of live streams coming for you live on this show.
Aren't we cool enough to have a Twitch account now?
Twitch is not even cool anymore. That's how cool we are. We're pioneers, and we're doing it on Twitter. Because, you know, yeah. Twitter is always there for us. It's not like other social media platforms that sometimes disappear for about 8 hours.
I was hanging out on the weekend by happenstance with some friends who were in their early 30s, which is, you know, a little bit younger than me. And it was just interesting having these conversations about social media. I'm like, God, I'm an old man. I'm on Twitter. And they're like, oh, that's cool. In that sort of condescending way that the youth talk to the olds. Anyway.
But it's all about the gram. But, you know.
See, not even twice. The gram or the millennials. Like, I've always said this before. Twitter is Gen X. I know you're on Twitter too, but it's like, yeah, primarily it's a Gen X platform. It's snark and it's sarcasm and it's
I'm born in 84. I'm literally between Gen X and millennials. I'm like on the cusp of both. That explains it.
They call you elder millennials, and most of my friends are elder millennials. Like, pretty much everyone I've ever dated in my life is an elder millennial too, right? When I think about it, not that we're going to get into this conversation, much different podcast. Anyway.
Oh, sure. Oh, too bad. I had my my bed ready for you and the consultation would have started, but you know.
Yeah. Anyhow. Fun to have those conversations. I've been more Instagramming at 24th Minute in the last little while. So, you know, you can watch me post pictures of statues and selfies. Anyhow, okay.
I might get on the gram eventually, because of course, if you've been following me, I've started a fitness journey. I'm a fourth week in. And is that something that would interest people? Would you like to hear me talk about my fitness journey? Should I record my thoughts on my fitness journey, what I'm actually doing? It's been my fourth week, and of course, I've down 13 pounds in 4 weeks. I've also became stronger already and already enjoying a better quality of life. But is that something interesting? If so, let me know, and maybe I'll whip up something.
Yeah, I always get in shape through the winter, and then I, let it go in the summer because I'm enjoying my summer anyway. But that's neither here nor there. Does your dog have an Instagram account? Because
my dog does have an Instagram account that is more popular than my very own.
I was gonna suggest that your dog probably would do very well on the gram. Anyhow,
yeah, my dog, it does very well on the Shelties of Instagram. But you know who's not doing well? You know who's really not doing well this year, Duane? That's FC Barcelona. The dogs of Barcelona are not going well on Instagram. Hashtag dogs of Barcelona. No, let's talk about FC Barcelona. Another loss this weekend. Right now, they are ninth in the table. They might as well be last. Ninth for Barcelona, might as well be last. The fans are giving up. They are talking so much, behind Koeman's back. And then you get to talking and get to hear what players think about him behind the scenes, and you get to hear people that played under Koeman a decade ago all the way to today saying, our training sessions weren't the best, we didn't get better under him. We forget the role of an educator, of a manager, so often. And when you're trying to give an organization its glory back and you can't get the most out of this club already, yeah, it's going to be a difficult time, because financially, it's not going to get any better for FC Barcelona. They're not going to be able to go on a spending spree. It's a lot of S's and a lot of P's, but on a spending spree from Ronaldinho to Thierry Henry to Luis Suarez, and continue to surround these type of players, of course, like Messi and Xavi and Busquets, and of course, I'm forgetting a couple. But yeah, that time's over. Now you're going to have to make do with a player who's been compared to trash earlier today on social media, Frankie de Jong, and other players that are not delivering so far this year.
Barcelona is a cluster of you-know-what right now, and that's just the bottom line. Like, they're going to have an injection of cash at some point to allow them to start to spend again. They're essentially on a salary budget. Well, they're not essentially. They're literally on a salary budget. They can't spend over a certain amount. That's why they have to look for free transfers. That's why they have to get rid of stars. It's, they wanted Messi back. That was the whole presidential campaign, was run off the backs of re-signing him, and it always seemed like there was more going on there, and I wonder whether Mr. Laporte didn't understand that, right? That he knew that he wasn't going to sign it, but he got the power and then left. This weekend was a real indicator, I think, of the power dynamic in La Liga. It's Atleti's the defending champions. We shouldn't forget that. And they have actually won the title 2 of the last 7 seasons. So it's not like this is a club that it shouldn't be considered amongst the top in that league. It's just, we're just used to the two power two dynamic, right? Year after year. I think that's going to be changing for a while. And if Suarez, they score the goal, Suarez taunts them on the field with the celebration after.
With the phone call. With the phone call, which is, not necessarily that I was expecting necessarily like, revolutionary great sportsmanship from Luis Suarez, but it's just I guess it just goes with the character. Speaking of our wrestling reference of the day, he's a heel, but he's embracing it, which means he's doing his job.
Yeah, he's entered his Ric Flair WWE kind of era, like late Flair, when he
where he doesn't give a damn and he's just there to collect his paycheck and score goals.
Yeah, he's kind of there now, right? This is a man who's bit people on the field. So what do you expect out of him? At any rate, it was kind of funny, though, if you're watching Barcelona blow up. And I know there's a lot of people that you know, they're, Barcelona is a club that isn't really that hated. I mean, they haven't been over the years, but what's happened they're in the last little while, and we've been talking about this on the show for like 3 or 4 years now, but this like idea that this is this higher than thou, you know,
more than a club. Más que un club. Nah.
Come on, man. It's not 1955 anymore, and you're not fighting a revolution there. Like, it's, you are the, one of the richest clubs in the world, and you pulled strings all the way around, and you waste overspent over their boundaries, and they're paying for it now. Yeah. What they're holding off for is, well, the Super League obviously was what they wanted. That is not going to happen in that same capacity, but I think that all of those clubs are still working behind the scenes to do something structurally that will allow them to go through, and some kind of change is going to happen.
You know what's going to happen, right? It's going to be like Major League Soccer's version of inter. So the MLS model, but to your European, like to your European, but the close format of MLS with every club becoming a franchise or something. Like, it'll be like that identity or something. That philosophy will be what the league, like the Super League, will be eventually one day or something. But yeah,
well, that's what they wanted to do, obviously, and people fought back against that. And, you know, I think that within the European context, not to open this conversation again, but in the European context, they'll always have to have some degree of openness to ever get it accepted. But the compromise that will probably come down, I think, actually, to do another North American comparison, might as well continue this conversation now, is that it would be more like the Mexican situation where they'll close relegation for X amount of years at a time and then reevaluate from there. And that's not going to make anyone happy. But like, we're marching towards changes in this sport. And we've always said, when we've talked about pro rel here in the context of North American soccer, that the conversation is silly. It really ultimately is, because it's never happening here, ever. And it's more likely to stop happening there than it is to start here.
It's probably going to disappear everywhere before it appears here. Anyways, let's just look at that table in La Liga, the top of the table, for a second. We were talking about Barcelona. They're right now ninth. They have 12 points after 7 games played, 3 wins, 3 losses, and 1 draw. 3 wins, 3 draws, sorry, and 1 loss this season. It's the draws. It's the unfortunate results against lower team. It's not just losing to Atletico Madrid last weekend. It's not doing well against smaller teams since the beginning of the season. It's not doing well in the Champions League so far. Koeman and the way they play is not inspiring also for the fans, and that's something that used to be very important for Barcelona. We'll see how that shapes up and changes. Real Madrid, Atletico Madrid, and Real Sociedad. One of the three doesn't belong, but they're all top of the table so far with 17 points.
Yeah, no, I've been watching a little bit of that mid-table, sort of mid-table, for lack of a better way to put it, La Liga action over the last little while, because it's on TSN now, so I just turn it on when it's on. Sometimes it's in my background, I'm not necessarily paying attention, but those clubs are good, and we forget how good they are because they're forgotten, because they've been behind the two huge clubs forever. Athletic's closed the gap, as I said there before, and in fact, they might even be the slight favorite to win at this point, if to be honest. Again, they're the defending champions, but those, you know, don't sleep on the Sociedads, on the Valencias, and on, you know, the other Reals that are out there, right? Yeah. Like, they're all decent sides, and yeah, we're seeing it here. Now, look, part of that is that Barca is struggling. How low can they fall? The lowest they've ever finished in their modern history is 6th, which is remarkable when you think about it. To never be below 6th in the first division of your country is, I mean, that there's lots of clubs that have been lower than that and that are considered clubs.
Exactly.
So that's my measure if I'm looking at them. Like, can they, you know, stay in the Champions League hunt? And it's weird to talk about Barca that way, but I do think that when you're looking at the title race this year, it goes through Madrid, one of the two sides, and that's just the bottom line in my mind.
No, I fully agree. I fully agree. And we'll see how it unfolds, and we'll see the reaction of Barcelona, if Koeman, because Koeman was Laporta, the president of Barcelona, the elected president of Barcelona, last week says, oh no, Koeman's going to stay after rumors that Pirlo would go and become manager of Barcelona.
Just real quick aside on that one, Pirlo, I know this is Tuesdays for Europe, but I think it's hilarious that Andrea Pirlo is being linked to two clubs, not as much the one. One is Barcelona.
One is Toronto FC.
Toronto FC, anyway. When does that ever happen in the world?
Yeah,
world
yeah. Anyway? And that's what we, for the last few shows, we've been making Italian jokes. That, like, if you want to follow TFC next year, you better learn to speak Italian. Well, that's what we mean.
Yeah, well, yeah, there's also some DP instructions out there. I'm not going to name any names.
No, exactly, because it's not... Yeah. It wouldn't do anyone justice right now to do that. But let's just say the Javinko rumors that are more than rumors. He was filmed in Toronto with his agent in the stadium. Like there's more than that. So he's not the agent of just this one player. That agent. Let me tell you.
Yeah. When it comes to real quick, when it comes to Javinko guys, they can't sign him to the end of the season because there's this thing called the allocation order within MLS. They'd have to trade for the top MLS or allocation spot. That would cost them more money or more asset than they need to spend right now to do that, since he's not going to come in and help the season that's lost anyhow. Yeah. They wait to the end of the year, the allocation flips. Suddenly, they're no longer going to be no lower than third, second, right? They're near the bottom, yeah. So they're not going to need to give up as much, probably like a third round draft pick. So there you go. That's why it's not happening now.
Exactly. And there's also some financial incentives that would be easier to do, and we'll see who's going to be in place and all the key positions for this to happen also. Starting next year, let's look at a few results in the Bundesliga, because Eintracht Frankfurt traveled to the Allianz Arena. Not the one in Minnesota, Duane. That's not the one in Minnesota that might receive a famous mid-season game in the next couple of years or so. I'm talking about the other Allianz Arena, the one that is in Munich. In Bavaria, and Eintracht Frankfurt came away with 3 points, 2-1 for them against Bayern Munich. Bayern Munich, of course, is in a first few matches of a new era. It's the Julian Nagelsmann era. It's the adjustment of the roster, their playing position. Just quickly on Alphonso Davies' example, he's been used of a more of a left attacking midfield and not necessarily as a left wing back over the last few games. It's that transition that is starting to take shape now that he's more used to having defensive responsibilities. Alphonso Davies is now going to be freed a bit more, higher up on that left side, to even more use more not only of his speed but also his right foot when he cuts back in. So that's going to be interesting to see, but it's a bit of that transition period. Not saying they're struggling. We're still looking at them top of the table, but they're not dominating as much as we've seen other years. Right now, top of the table with Bayer Leverkusen equal on point. Bayern Munich, of course, is on top because of their goals for, which is 24, and they've only conceded 7 times this year for a plus 17 differential after 7 games played.
Well, yeah, I mean... I'm trying. Is it their 9th or their 10th straight title they're going for this year? It's around there at any rate.
Yeah, you're right. It's about that. I don't even remember when was the last time.
I remember wearing t-shirts with 8 on it after they won a title, and I don't know whether that was the pandemic year or it was last season. So it's either 9 or 10. Regardless, what happens is complacency is a strongly to put it, but it is kind of that. It's boredom. Like, to get through a season, there's always going to be some weird results at the start for those clubs, and then they eventually just grind through the winter when their depth starts to play out. And, like, no one thinks that anyone other than Bayern Munich's winning the Bundesliga. Like, at this point in time, there would be no greater upset in world football in my mind than Bayern Munich not winning the Bundesliga. I can't even conceptualize how it happens, because when you got the most likely club to maybe nick them one year would be Dortmund, you'd think. You know, it might have been Leipzig a couple of years ago, you might have said, but then you kind of look at their model now is more focused towards development. And even at the Leipzig level, they're not necessarily going to hold on to these guys forever, as you've seen them move on, even their coach, right? You know?
Well, it's the coach went from Leipzig to Bayern Munich. And of course, when you're talking about Leipzig, I can put up the table right now of Germany. They're 8 right now. They're 3 wins, 1 draw, and 3 losses so far under Jesse March in the Bundesliga. 10 points. Yes, they're on a good run of form now, unbeaten in 3, but he started with a couple of losses to begin the season. A win, 3 losses, and then the rest here for RB Leipzig. not an easy task. Dortmund right now is third, which is maybe the biggest contender for the title if they can hold on to Haaland for the entire season, which is probably going to be the case. Might be his last season with Dortmund. But can he perform to a level where they're on top of the table? But also, Dortmund needs to play in a way where they have more than just Haaland performing for this team. Because you can't beat Bayern Munich with one talisman player. That's, in my mind, impossible. You need three. You need a three-headed monster to beat those type of team. Because Bayern Munich is a 3-4-5-11-headed monster.
Well, yeah, at least. I mean, you know, we talk about Alphonso Davies all the time on this show. But within the pecking order of Bayern Munich, he's probably like 8th, 9th, right? Like,
well, yeah, definitely. And sometimes he's better. Sometimes he's higher when he's on a great run of form. But that's what Alphonso Davies has been too in the Bundesliga so far. A player that gets on a great run of form, and then he gets a little knock, and then it brings him a bit down, and then he gets back to this great, amazing level, and hopefully he can maintain that. But you're looking at Lewandowski, Goretzka, Serge Gnabry. Want me to continue? It's a ton of players. And then not even talking about the young guns that are starting to play with this team too.
Oh, 100%. Look, yeah, as I said, I don't think there'd be a greater upset in world football. I mean, when I say that, I'm like ignoring, you know, leagues that have had the same team win, you know, the Greek league or something. But it's like Olympiakos has won like 47 of the last 52 titles or something.
But one time that Ajax won, it was an amazing party.
Yeah, like, I mean, yeah, it's, you know, there are leagues out there that are like that. But I think in terms of the big leagues, obviously Bayern Munich has just really pulled away. And that's, you know, to tie this back into the Champions League, the Super League talk that we were talking about earlier, like when that talk was happening, obviously we're in North America, so we have a different perspective. My mind was like, I don't like what they're talking about here, but I also see how there needs to be a breaking point at some point, because I don't ever want to see teams restricted in how ambitious they can be. That I don't like salary caps for that reason. So I don't like it when people talk about salary caps within the context of European football. I don't think it'll accomplish what they think it will. But at the same time, I acknowledge that seeing Bayern Munich win 9 straight titles is not that compelling either. They're a fun team to watch, but the race is not that fun. And, you know, you see Haaland is like, that's how Dortmund would win, is they would keep him, but they can't because the big clubs are just predatory and they're coming above them. Like, there's rumors to this week, today, actually, because Mo Salah hasn't signed his contract. I'm going to tie this in, trust me. Mo Salah hasn't signed his contract for Liverpool yet to renew it, and there's been a lot of pressure for them to do so because he's, you know, among their best players they've ever had there, and obviously scored a brilliant goal in the weekend. So even today there was a suggestion that Man City was going to come in for him in January, like they're going to put a bid in just to get it public. I think that has as much to do with them reminding Dortmund that Haaland is going to go somewhere, so they might as well get some money for him, right? And so they can deal with that at that point. That's the how the big clubs operate. They're always looking to grab, and if you are Dortmund, you can't compete with that, which means you'll never be able to consistently compete to win a title. And that's kind of just sad. But
so I don't know if you're a poker guy, but sometimes at a poker table, your cards don't mean squat. Sometimes it's just the size of your chips, like the size of your stack, because you can be a bully at a poker table in a way where if you have a very, very big stack of chips and your opponent in a head-to-head has a lot less, and you decide to bet the amount they have all the time, because at one point they're going to have to go with it. They're going to have to call you on it if they really want to advance in life. And if they do so, there's a high probability that they could lose, because it is what it is, right? And that's what they can do, is you paint themselves in a corner. Like, that bully will force that decision over and over and over again. And that one time when you keep that player, you might do something well. But that 9 times out of 10, Lewandowski signed for Dortmund, didn't he? When you think about Lewandowski, you don't even think about a Dortmund player anymore. That's exactly what it is. They kept Marco Reus. Oh, yeah, big deal. Where has he been? He's been on that side of that carton of milk since 2017. That's what happens. That's literally the best example of a bully. That's what they are, the bully at a poker table. That's what City, that's what Chelsea, that's what Bayern Munich are.
Yeah, Yeah. Sometimes you got to know when to hold them. Sometimes you got to know when to fold them. Sometimes you got to know when to walk away.
You got to know when to run.
Yeah.
You got to count your money before you talk to turntable. All right.
Ever really listen to the lyrics of that song? It is dark. The best that you can hope for is to die in your sleep is a lyric in Kenny Rogers, The Gambler. Anyway.
Well, yeah. You know how I learned that song when I was a kid? Well, a little older than a kid. It's because it was redone by Wyclef. So I actually love Wyclef's version of that song.
I'm not going to lie. I am a fan of what I would call classic country, not modern junk that is not country. It's just pop with a twang. But yeah, I would consider Kenny Rogers to be in that. He's a storyteller. I mourned his death when it happened, a year and a half ago now?
Yeah, a couple times.
I have the best Kenny Rogers. I'm a record player over here. And when I say record player, I mean literal record player because I'm, of course, a middle-aged man with a record player living in a hip part of Toronto. Anyway,
Of course, exactly. Yeah, vinyl. Yeah. It's all about the vinyl. Exactly. It sounds better, they say.
Yeah, it's just kind of fun to hold things. Anyway.
Yeah, that's what she said.
Back to my dating life again.
It's kind of fun to hold things, she said. But speaking of, it's Bayern Munich. It's going to hold the title at the end of the season.
Yeah, no, that's please go back to that. Yes.
Yeah, it's about time I think we had the show for today.
Okay, cool. Yeah. City Liverpool, great game of the weekend.
Well, no, exactly. That's where I wanted to go to. City Liverpool 2-2. Great game. Liverpool taking the lead late at the 78th minute with Mo Salah scoring that goal. It wasn't meant to be. City got the equalizer and they shared the points right now at the top of the table in the Premier League. I am going to mention it because I think I'm contractually obligated to do so. Chelsea, top of the table, followed by Liverpool, followed by City, United, Everton, and Brighton, all equal on 14 points. Chelsea 16 after 7 games, Liverpool 15 points. Chelsea, the only team in the Premier League with 5 wins so far this season. They also did not face all 5 amazing great teams. That's also what we call calendar effect on the table so far. But Chelsea, only one loss this season. Can you believe week 7? And there's only, though, one remaining unbeaten team in the Premier League. And that is Liverpool, the last sole unbeaten team this year. But that's probably not going to last that long. But yes, you're right. 2-2. It was a great game this weekend.
Yeah, we've been long already, so we won't belabor this. And there's been a lot of talk about it already. It was just a wonderful game of football. And, I that second half in particular, I thought the first half was, kind of what you'd expect in a City game this year. A lot of ball, a lot of, scary-looking attack, but ultimately no finish. When the second half rolled in, and it wasn't just that there were 4 goals in the second half, that they were 4 great goals in the second half, right? And it just was a great game. If you were neutral, you had to enjoy it, unless perhaps you were like a fan of, United or something. But I think at the start of the year, a lot of people were undercutting Liverpool's chances because I think they forgot how good they were. They forgot how good Mo Salah was, and that goal is maybe the best goal we'll see this year. Like, I think it will be the goal of the year, unless recency bias comes in the second half. But like, that's hard. Like, I watched it at the City Pub, and it was just sun silence when it happened because you could see it happen. It's like a Maradona goal, right? Like, oh my God, how he's still going? What is happening here? And then he scores from a tight angle too. But that said, City comes back and shows their capabilities. This after back to back seasons, or really the last. What was the last great title chase would have been the one where City the 98-97 season. So that's like 8 points to 97 points. That was 3 years ago, 4 years ago now.
Yeah, it was City's really first in the trot, right? So it was 2018-19, I believe.
Yeah, so it's been a couple of years since we've had a decent title race, and it's been a long time since we've had a 3-way title race, and I think we're shaping up to have that this year. So maybe I'll just leave it at that right now, and we'll slide into the international break reluctantly here, and go from there.
Oh, we got a lot to talk to, though, during this international break, because, of course, over the next few days, we'll talk about Canada on their journey on the road to Qatar with the United States also in Mexico. That's this window, Canada, Mexico. That'll be crazy. That'll be insane, and it's soon. And also, Our journey to the MLS Cup playoff will start very soon, a month away. That goes very quick. But before that, World Cup qualifiers. And of course, tomorrow on this show, it's the annual tradition, the FIFA review, FIFA 22 review. And maybe I'll do an eFootball review eventually, because apparently that game is terrible. And apparently it's been the worst game in the history of video games. It has 0.84% rating right now on Steam and all those places. So worst game ever is eFootball. A lot of new players on FIFA this year and later today. On this account, you can watch me play live. I'll be playing with my created team. I'll be playing online. I'll do whatever it takes to have some fun with FIFA 22. Live for you when Kevin plays return on this very account. And you can find the replay of our shows, of our live streams on our YouTube page at youtube.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. And as always, until tomorrow, have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.